Hello, in this video, I'm going to show you everything about getting one or more servos working in ESPHome, from just the basics to some advanced settings like calibration, initial position, and then control with Home Assistant and automation. A big thank you to PCBWay for sponsoring this video. More on them later. I'm using an ESP32 dev board. I've got a red wire onto the 5-volt pin down the bottom here. I've got a black wire onto one of the grounds. There's a couple of grounds on these boards. And I've got a white wire there. That's going onto GPIO 50. Those come up to a little connector that I've made. We've got the black wire going into the ground of the servo. The red, which is the 5 volts, that goes onto this reddish orangey wire in the middle there of the servo. And then finally, our signal on the white wire there onto the orange. So I'll put that on the desk and let's have a look at the code. I've got the board connected to 5 volts. This is coming off a USB charger. And I set up the boilerplate for the ESP32 boards. So the servo needs two components. One is the servo itself and an output. I'll paste that in there as well. So the servo itself just needs an ID so you can reference it elsewhere. It doesn't have a name or anything. You can't actually directly control this servo from the servo component. The output, as I'm using an ESP32, I'm using the LEDC library. If you're running a D1 Mini or any other ESP8266, then you would use the ESP8266_PWM library. Next up is the ID. That's the name for the output, which the servo is going to be using. So I just called that output 1. The pin I'm using is 15, as we've shown. Next up is the frequency. Now the output component by default will have a frequency of 1 kHz or 1000 Hz. All servos use a 50 Hz PWM signal. So just make sure you've got a frequency there of 50 Hz. As I say, the servo can't be controlled directly. What I like to do is add a number component. So here's my code for my number. Now the servo control for its rotation, it uses a range from -1 through 0 to +1. Now I've made my number -100 through to 100, and effectively that is 100% in one direction, 100% in another direction. Now servos themselves will only rotate 90 degrees each way. So to get the number to control the servo, I'm going to use an automation of on value, which will basically do something every time this number or slider is changed. So the automation I want to do is servo write. Next up, I'm going to indent one. It needs an ID, and that is the ID of the servo. So I'm just going to copy that, paste that in there. And then it needs a level. For the servo write, the level is going to be what I want to send to the servo component. So that'll be within the range of -1, 0, +1. Well, I want to send the value of this slider. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to add a lambda. In standard boilerplate for lambda, and then we'll come in, we'll just tab in one. And I'm going to return x divided by 100. And we'll just tidy up the code here. So that's basically it. We need the servo component, an output component for the servo, and something to drive the servo component. In this example, I'm going to use the number. And of course, with a lambda, you need to end it with that. So let's flash that to the board. All right then, let's flash to the board. And I've already brought in the control from ESPHome add-on in Home Assistant. So as you can see, we've got a slider now. Now for some reason, this servo does a sort of random thing. But if we update this, so take it away, put it back to 0. You can see now that's roughly in the center. It's not going to be perfect. All servos are different. We can calibrate that and we'll get to that in a second. So if I go -100, that's 100% clockwise. If I go 100% positive, that goes completely to the other side. And as I say, 0 is roughly in the middle. And we can obviously set this to different angles or percentages of the range. Now, as you can see, I've got -100 to +100. But what about if you wanted an angle? Well, that's simple enough. We can just change the range to -90 and 90. Remember, this only goes 90 degrees each way off of center. So I can have an angle there. Now, obviously, I'm not dividing by 100 anymore. I only need to divide by 90. So if we install that, right, that's rebooted. So we can see now that my slider goes from -90 to +90. And if I go to -90, that goes all the way in that direction. That one obviously goes all the way in the other direction. Still, we need to calibrate it. But if I was to go 45 now, that's roughly 45 degrees. And if I go -45, go 45 degrees in the other direction. So you can get an angle if you want, rather than 100% on these things. One thing I like to do in the automation of this number, and we've got the servo right here, which is controlling the servo component, and that's like four lines of code, but we can do better. Now I'm going to streamline this with a single lambda command. So I'm going to get rid of all of this. I'm going to have a lambda command. I'm going to do an exclamation mark, another lambda, space, no colon, then we want pipe minus, and then in that it's just a single line, which is ID, the servo name. So I'm just going to copy that, put that in there, dot write, and then we want to set the value. So in this case it is x divided by 100, and then finish the line, need a semicolon, so we can get rid of all these lines. As you can see, that's a lot neater. Next thing, we're going to tackle the fact that this thing doesn't go to zero every time. Now, even though I've set the initial value of the slider to be zero, for some reason this servo is slightly off. Even though I've set the horn to be the middle, the servo is not going back to the middle every time. Now to do that, I'm going to go up to the ESPHome, and I'm going to add another automation into this code, and this is the onBoot. Now I'm going to set the priority to be negative 100, and that will just make sure that everything is loaded, and then I'm going to change the value of this number. So I'm going to make a similar lambda call to what I've made here. So this is servo right, and I'm sending it x, which is the value of the slider. I just want to send it zero. Now we have to do something slightly different here. So I'm going to do a then the lambda, and the code for this, as I say, it's slightly different. Instead of doing the lambda to control the servo, I'm doing the lambda to control the slider. So the ID for this one is going to be slider1, which is the ID I've called my first slider. We're going to make the call, set the value of 0, and then perform. So basically what it's doing, who you're going to call, slider1, what you're going to call, set value, and then actually perform it. So let's tidy up the code again. So on boot, this is going to be pretty much the last thing. As you can see here, at this priority, pretty much everything should already be initialized. So everything in ESPHome is going to be initialized, including the number, the servo, and the output. Then I'm going to send 0 to the number again, even though it is 0. That's going to change the value, and then on the value, it's going to change the servo. Trust me, it works. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move the slider, put the servo in a off position, and let's install. Right, so there you go. Now, as soon as ESPHome boots, we should see that go back to 0. And there you go. That's pretty much 0. And again, we've got to 100% either way. Next up, let's have a look at a few of the options that we've got for the servo. Now on the white wire, I've got a PWM signal running, and at the moment, that's running all the time. So if we grab hold of the servo, we can see that that's locked because it's powered all the time. So that's sitting there. If I can move it. No, I can't even move that. These servers have got quite a lot of torque on, so they will have a fair amount of holding force, but we don't need to power this if it's sitting in a single position. So there's a setting we can add to the servo component, and that is auto detach time. And what this does is, after a certain amount of time, turn off the motor effectively. So let's say 5 seconds. So that's turning the servo off. There's another option we can add to servo, and that is the transition length. This is essentially the same as the transition length of a light, so the fade time, if you like. Except for a servo, it's the speed, essentially. 0 is maximum speed, and we can change it all the way up to, I think it's about 10. This will make the servo run quite slow. So that's going to be too slow, I think. So I'm going to put it to 5. So we're going to install that. There you go, servo started in the random position. As soon as the ESPHome boots, that goes back to 0. Now, if we look at the speed now, if I put this all the way to 100%, you can see how slow that's going. Again, the other direction. Now, also, you can see here in the output, we've got servo target reached. 5 seconds after that, it's detached. So the auto detach will wait for the servo to reach its position before auto detaching. So you don't have to worry about the timings there. And then if we look at the servo again, we can see that's now no longer locked. And if we get it going, I can push it around with one finger. So there is a little bit of holding torque there, but you can overcome it and push it. So that servo is now no longer locked in position. So something to be aware of if you need this to hold something with the auto detach. Like I say, there is a little bit of holding force there, but you can turn it. So depending on how long your arm is on what you're controlling, that may be a factor. I'm going to put that down to 0 so the maximum speed is achieved, and we'll just save that. Another option we have for servos is a little bit of calibration. Even though I've set this to zero, it's not quite vertical there. And if I go to all the way to this side, we can see that that's not quite 90 degrees. And then this direction, that's pretty much okay. So what we can do is we can set up some values. Yeah, it's a little bit more centered and 90 degrees in each direction. Now let's put this back down to zero. We'll do the zero point first. Again, in the servo component, we've got three things that we can control. So we've got the minimum level, idle level, and the max level. Now, by default, the minimum level will be 3%, idle level will be 7.5%, and the max level is 12.5%. Now, these default values are currently what the servo is running. So we'll start with the idle level. So that's currently 7.5, and as we can see, that's slightly over. Let's make that 7.7. I'm going to install that and see what it does. So we'll just wait for that to boot and the on boot to put it back to zero. So we can see there, you see it jumped a little bit. We can see that that is pretty much in the center now. So let's have a look at the max level. That looks to be okay. I'm going to keep the max level as is at the default, 12.5. And let's have a look at the minimum value. Maybe a little bit low, but I'm not too concerned about that. That looks quite nice. So there you go. We've calibrated this servo quite nicely. Right then, let's get into some advanced stuff. So first of all, I've got five servos connected. I've got the ESP32 connected via a little interface board here. So I've just taken all the wires here from various different GPIO pins onto a little bit of variable there, connected to all my five servos. You probably could run two, possibly three servos from the 5-volt pin via the USB port, but it's kind of going to tax it a little bit. The tracks on here is only an amp or so. So I'm running an external power supply that's going on to 5-volt pins of each one of the servos, and also bringing out 5 volts and connecting that to the 5-volt pin there. So that board is now powered from the external power supply by this PCB I made. Talking of PCBs, get your custom PCBs ordered in three simple steps at PCBWay. Upload your Gerber file. Order up to 10 PCBs for as little as $5. Choose from a list of colours and other options. With flexible payment and shipping options, get your PCBs the easy way at PCBWay.com. So in the code, you can see that the servo component, I've copied and pasted servo 1 to servo 2, 3, 4, and 5. And also, I've replicated the output. So I've got output 1 on pin 15 that we had before. Output 2 is on pin 2. And I've got 3, 4, and 5. And these are pretty much all duplicates apart from the pin. I've also, in the on boot, I've set up all 5 sliders to go to 0. Just copied and pasted that. And also, I've added another function. As you can see here, I've got a switch called servo tester, and that's what I've called all of these sliders. If I turn that on, nothing's going to happen at the moment because I've got a range slider, which is set to 0. If I set the range to, let's say, 100%, the slider's going up and down, and you can see that the servo is going backwards and forwards, and I've also added the speed control. So if I turn it to 100% speed, now 100% speed is faster backwards and forwards than that servo is capable of moving. So it's not going to get to either end fast enough before the slider changes. So if I turn that speed down a little bit, we can see that there's a nice sine wave on there, and I can go a little bit faster, I think, before it gets too fast for the servo to catch up. So that's pretty much the limit. This is going minus 100 to 100, but the servo's just about getting there. So that's probably a little bit too fast, so we'll turn that down. So let me show you the code that I've done for that. So first of all, let's look at the switch. So if we go down, it's just a template switch. I've given it an ID and I've given it a name. Next up is the sine wave generating code. I'm using the interval to generate the code, and I'm using some globals. Now the globals here, the first one is recording the phase of the sine wave. I can't put a variable in here and initialize it because every time the interval gets run, that phase will get reset. I'm going to bring in that global into a value of T, so the sine wave phase here. I'm also bringing in the range and the speed. So we've got sine wave range, which is here, and we've got sine wave speed, which is another global. Now both of these globals have a default value. So the range, as you remember, this started off at range 0, and the speed here was speed 1. To change these values, the phase gets changed by the code, and we'll get into that in a little bit, but the range and the sine wave are two additional number components or sliders. So the first one's called servo range, and I've given it a name of range, which is this one here. Second one is servo speed. I've given that a name of speed. And then both of these, when the slider gets updated, the first one's going to write to sine wave range. And if we go back up here, that's what this one's called. So that value is stored in here for the code to read. And the same with sine wave speed. And that's our second slider. So looking at the code for the interval, what this is going to do is every 40 milliseconds, it's going to run this code. Now it's only going to run this code because I've got a condition, which is the switch is on, which as you remember is the sine enabled here. So this code won't do anything until I turn the switch on. And what it's going to do is work out the sine of the value of phase. And then it's going to round it up for the slider. And then it's going to publish the state value to the servo slider 5. Now let's look at a way that we can command these servos within Home Assistant. The first is a call service. So what we're going to do, we're going to control the number, which is the slider in this case, and the slider is controlling the servo. So if we look at our first servo, we can see that it's called number.servotester1. So we want to control the number. And we don't want an input number, that's a Home Assistant helper. What we actually want is number set. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to choose an entity, and if I do tester, it will find it. And again, this is number.servo_tester_1. And what we want to do, we want to send it a value. So I'm going to enable value, and I'm going to type in a value here that I want to send it. So currently, it's minus 100. So let's set it to 55. And if I do a call service, we can see it set the slider to 55, and our servo's gone to the 55 position. We can add all of them in here. So if I do tester again, we'll go tester 2, tester 3, tester 4, tester 5, and let's put that all to 0. They've all gone to 0, and so are the sliders. So we can set any value we like here, command it, and all the servos will go to that position. And of course, we can look at the YAML for this call service. Now that we know how to do this, we can use an automation. Now I've written two automations here. I've got one that will set them all to 0. So if I run that, and I've got another one that runs through a little sequence. So if I run this, so let's have a look at these automations. So have a look at the first one. We can see it's the call service of number set, all 5 servos, and I've given it a value of 0. No trigger, it's just for demo, but obviously you can set this to any trigger that you want. And for the cascade, done a little bit more extensive programming here. So the first thing we do is servo 1, we set it to minus 100. Then I'm going to do delay of 0.5 seconds. Then I'm going to set servo 2 to minus 100. And then the same for all 5. Then I'm going to wait another 0.5 second. And then servo 1 is going to go all the way to 100. And then we cascade the rest, 0.5 second in between. Servo 2 then goes to 100, 3, 4, and 5. So rather than looking at that, let's go to the YAML. So we've got a bit more of a list here. So we can see that we've got no trigger, no condition. The action is set number. The value is minus 100 and the target is servo tester 1. Then we've got the delay and then number set value for 2, another delay, 3, 4. And then at the end of 5, we do another delay of 500 milliseconds, which is 0.5 second. And then obviously we do a number set of 100 for servo 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So if we go back to the visual editor, you can copy and paste in here, but I prefer to write it in the YAML. It's just a lot easier, as I'll show you how easy it is to do. I'm going to delete everything here. So my cascade servos is just number set value for the first one. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to highlight all of those. Not the same in VS Code and ESPHome. I can hold down Shift, Alt, and down arrow. And you can see that's copied that. So all I need to do now is replace 2, select that new group again, Shift, Alt, down, replace it with 3, and so on. So it just makes it a little bit easier to write the code there. And I'm going to leave that so it goes back to what we had. Well, I hope this video was helpful for your projects. Please do share it so others can find it as well. I upload videos whenever I can, so subscribe and hit the bell icon to get notified. That's it. Thanks for watching.
Okay, I love you. Bye-bye.